Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. Wa afdalu salati wa tammu taslimi ala Sayyidina Muhammad al-Sadiq al-Wa'di al-Amin. Wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa matabi'ahum bi ihsanin wa da'a bi da'watihim ila yawmiddin. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala ali Muhammad kama sallaita ala Ibrahim wa ala ali Ibrahim innaka hamidun majid. Allahumma barik ala Muhammad wa ala ali Muhammad kama barakta ala Ibrahim wa ala ali Ibrahim innaka hamidun majid. رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي امري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقهوا قولي سبحانك لا علم لنا الا ما علمتنا انك انت العليم الحكيم اللهم انفعنا بما علمتنا وعلمنا ما ينفعنا وزدنا علما وعملا يا رب العالمين اما بعد السلام عليكم ورحمه الله وبركاته So as always, we begin by praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who has gathered us here today to listen to the words of Allah and His Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to accept this gathering of ours, and we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make this gathering of ours a means of success for us in this life and in the life hereafter, inshaAllah. So we are continuing the story of Umar radiallahu anhu, and we are currently talking about the conquest that took place at the time of Umar radiallahu anhu, and we are currently talking about the Persian Empire, how the Persian Empire collapsed in the hands of the Muslims during the time of Umar radiallahu anhu. So yesterday we talked about one very, very important battle, a very huge battle in Islamic history, which was called the Battle of Qadisiyah. Now we talked about how the battle took place, the reasons behind the battle, you know, how the Muslims, you know, conquered the opponents, because this was a huge, huge battle. Right, you had 120,000 soldiers on the other side, and you only had 30,000 Muslims. And you know, we had a great leader by the name of Rustum, who also eventually got killed in this battle as well. So we talked about all of these things yesterday. Now today we're going to continue, and we're going to now talk about the aftermath of the Battle of Qadisiyah. So what happened was we mentioned this yesterday, that the booty of war was divided between the fighters, and 20% normally goes to the state. So what happened, this 20% of the booty was sent with a few people all the way to Medina to Umar radiallahu anhu. Umar radiallahu anhu, he received a letter from Sa'd ibn Abi Waqas radiallahu anhu, saying, you know, he described what happened in the battle. So he explained to Umar that this was a very difficult battle. It lasted 4 days, and you know, there was approximately 5,000 to 8,000 people who got martyred. So out of 30,000, approximately 8,000 people got martyred in this battle. Now what happened was, after this battle, Umar radiallahu anhu, he wrote to Sa'd ibn Abi Waqas radiallahu anhu, and he told him that continue marching and continue conquering, and you know, go to the capital of the Persian Empire. So the capital of the Persian Empire was Al-Madain, and we said that they conquered Al-Madain. They walked into the huge castle of the Kisra, Yazdazraj at that time. They walked in, and you know, they weren't impressed by, you know, the dunya, because these were the Sahaba radiallahu anhu. And after that, they continued marching, and a few other battles took place. Namely, we had the Battle of Jawr and the Battle of Tastur. Right now, these are all places in Iran, current day Iran. Now, what happened was, the Battle of Jawr wasn't a very, very difficult battle, but the Battle of Tastur was quite a difficult battle. Now, before this battle took place, the Sahaba, they went to a person, a Sahabi by the name of Bara ibn Mu'azib radiallahu anhu. Now the reason why they went to him was to request him to make dua. Now why did they ask him for dua and no one else? Because he was mustajabul da'wa. Mustajabul da'wa means if he makes dua, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accepts his dua. And furthermore, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says in one hadith that rubba ash'ath aghbar لَوْ أَقْسَمَ عَلَى اللَّهِ لَأَبَرَّهُ. That there is certain people who, if you look at them, they don't look very attractive. Their hair is disheveled. The way they dress is not very presentable. They, you know, their clothes are dusty, etc. But they have such a status in the sight of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that if they were to say by Allah, or they were to take an oath that by Allah such and such thing will happen, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will fulfill that oath. Right? These are such people. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says that one of these people is Al-Bara ibn Azib radiallahu anhu. Now this is why, you know, they all went to Al-Bara radiallahu anhu and they said, you know, make dua, we're going to face a very, very difficult battle. And by the way, this Sahabi, he was a very, very brave Sahabi. They say that he was so courageous that it was dangerous for the Muslims. This is how courageous he was. He was so brave that he was too brave. And this is why Umar radiallahu anhu, he wrote to whenever he would send al-Bara to join an army, he would send a letter, you know, to the leader of the army saying that make sure you don't appoint al-Bara as the leader of any army, because he's too brave and he gets too passionate and he's going to cause destruction to the Muslims. So make sure you don't appoint him as a leader. This is how brave he was. So now anyway, he made dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that Allah gives them victory and Allah gives him shahada as well. He made two duas, right? That Allah gives the Muslim victory and oh Allah give me shahada. So now the battle of Tastur began. And when they began the battle, it was a very intense battle again, but eventually the Muslims won. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accepted the dua of Al-Bara ibn Azib radiallahu anhu, and he became a shaheed in this particular battle. Now, the leader or the governor of this area where they went, his name, the governor of the Persian Empire, his name was Al-Hurmuz, right? Al-Hurmuz. Now, because what you had in the Persian Empire, you had the emperor who was who? No, Kisra passed away a long time ago. Yes, Dazraj, right? Now, he was the emperor of the Persian Empire. And then you had you had loads of states in the Persian Empire. And each of these states, they had a governor, or like a mini king, if you like, right? Now, this governor, or this mini king, was Hurmuz in this area. Hurmuz was captured, and he said, I don't want you to kill me. I don't want you to make any decision with regards to my fate. I only want your leader, Amir al-Mu'mineen, Umar radiallahu anhu, to make a decision with regards to my fate. So Sa'd ibn Abi Waqqas radiallahu anhu said, okay, that's fine. He sent a few people all the way to Medina. He said that take al-Hurmuz all the way to Medina and meet Umar radiallahu anhu. So they took him to Medina. When they got to Medina, they asked the people, where is Amir al-Mu'mineen? They said that Amir al-Mu'mineen, he's in the masjid, he's meeting a few people who have come from Iraq. So they went to the masjid, but no one was there. So they went out of the masjid, and they started walking around looking for Umar radiallahu anhu in the valleys of Medina until they came across a few children. And these few children, they asked these people that, why are you people walking around as if you're lost? Right, you're from Medina, why are you walking around as if you're lost? Who are you looking for? They said that, have you seen Amir al-Mu'mineen? Where is Umar? They said, he's in the masjid, he's resting in the masjid, right? So they went back to the masjid of the Prophet ﷺ, and they entered the masjid and they saw Umar radiallahu anhu sleeping in the corner of the masjid, right? Humbleness of Umar. Sleeping in the corner of the masjid. Now Al-Hurmuz, when he was brought to Medina, he was wearing the same clothes which he used to wear when he was on his throne, right? So he had the crown, he had the cloak that he was wearing, he had all the jewelry that he was wearing, and he came in this state to Medina. So he entered the masjid of the Prophet ﷺ. Now he was expecting Umar radiallahu anhu to be a person who's got expensive clothes on, was sitting on a beautiful throne, who's got a crown, beautiful jewelry, so many guards around him, a big entourage, etc. But when he entered the masjid, they went to this person who was sleeping on the floor. And he said that, where's Umar? The Al-Hurmuz, right? Al-Hurmuz, the Persian king. He said, where is Umar? Where is your leader? He said, our leader is here sleeping on the floor, right? So he said that, where's his guards? He said that he has no guards. Where's his throne? He has no throne. Where's his crown? He has no crown. So Al-Hurmuz, he was astonished that, this is the humbleness of the Muslims, the leader of the Muslims, the great Umar. Now everyone knew about Umar, right? We knew about, the Persian Empire knew about the power of the Muslims. So just imagine now the power of Amir al-Mu'mineen, Umar radiallahu anhu. So he was expecting all of this, all of these things that he had in his mind, but he was shocked. Now what happened was, people started gathering in the masjid because they found out, the word spread that the Persian king is in Medina, right? And he's wearing all of these beautiful clothing, these crowns, and people came to watch the scene, basically. So when the kids started coming in the masjid, the women started gathering in the masjid, the men started gathering in the masjid. And once this commotion gathered, Umar radiallahu anhu eventually woke up. When he woke up, he said that, are you Al-Hurmuz? Yes, are you Al-Hurmuz? He said, yes, I'm Al-Hurmuz. And he said to him that, why did you deceive us? Because what used to happen is, there used to be some states wherein the Muslims used to have a treaty with the Persian Empire. But then as soon as Yazdazrad, he became a leader, he said, break all your treaties, right? Whatever agreement you have made with the Muslims, break those agreements. So he used to do this a lot. Whenever the Muslims used to come to attack the state, they would say, okay, we'll make an agreement with you and we'll make a treaty, and that's it, they would leave it as that. But then when they would go away, they would break that treaty. So he used to deceive the Muslims a lot. So you asked that, why do you do this, etc. And he said that, oh Umar, I want to tell you the truth, but I'm scared that if I tell you the truth, you're going to kill me. So Umar radiallahu anhu said that I'm not going to kill you. So he said to me, so he said to Umar that I'm a bit thirsty, can I have some water? And now listen to this, I'm a bit thirsty, can I have some water? So Umar radiallahu anhu said, yes, of course, have some water. He told a few people to go and get a glass of water. And look at the arrogance of this person, right? Radiallahu anhu, he became a Muslim later on, we'll talk about this. So he fresh water, he got water from, you know, from this person. And the container or the glass that was presented to Hurmus was, you know, made out of wood, etc. It wasn't very presentable. And this being a Persian king, so much wealth, etc. He was used to, you know, plates and cutlery made of gold and, you know, all of this expensive material. So anyway, when the water came, he said that I would rather die of thirst than, you know, drink water from this. I'd rather die of thirst than drink water from this. Give me a proper glass. So Umar radiallahu anhu, he could have easily, you know, taken his anger out and, you know, given one whack around the face, but he didn't. He was humble and he told, you know, the same companion that go and get a better glass for Hurmus. So they went and they got a better glass for Hurmus. And he said, oh Umar, you know, when Hurmus got the glass in his hand, he was shaking, right, because he was scared. He was shaking and he said, I'm scared that you're going to kill me. So he said that, listen, until you don't drink water, I'm not going to kill you. Right? Drink your water first, then I'll think about killing you, right? So he said, then what happened? Because he was shaking so much, that glass eventually fell down and all the water, it spilled on the floor. Now, he said that, go and get another glass of water for Hurmus, Umar radiallahu anhu. He said, no, it's okay. He said that, you gave me your word that as long as I don't drink water, you're not going to kill me. So I'm not going to drink water now. Can you see? Now this Hurmus, he's been deceiving Muslims all this time. Now he's standing in front of Amir al-Mu'mineen, the leader of the Muslims, and he's still deceiving Amir al-Mu'mineen, right? He said that, you know, I'm not going to drink water because if I drink water, then it gives you a chance, you know, for you to kill me. So now I've got this security. You have given me security. You have given me security that as long as I don't drink that water, you're not going to kill me. So now Umar radiallahu anhu got angry. And he said that I will not be deceived by a non-Muslim. So Anas ibn Malik radiallahu anhu, who was there, he said that, but O Amir al-Mu'mineen, you gave your word to him. You gave your word, and as Muslims, you can't break our word. You as the leader of the believers, you can't break your word. He said, I'm not going to be deceived by a non-Muslim. So then Hurmus, he said, okay, then I'll accept Islam. Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, wa ashhadu anna Muhammad Rasulullah. He became a Muslim, right? And Umar radiallahu anhu, he couldn't say anything to him, right? Allahu a'lam, you know, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows how sincere Hurmus was. But you know, inshallah, he was sincere. But we don't know how sincere he was. So Umar radiallahu anhu, when he heard that Hurmus has accepted Islam, he told Hurmus that you may go now. You've been released. I can't do anything to you now, right? And Hurmus resided in Medina. Hurmus resided in Medina for the rest of his life, right? Now, coming back to the Persian Empire and the Muslims there, after the Battle of Tastur was, you know, the Muslims were victorious, Umar radiallahu anhu told them to march on, continue conquering the cities, and until they reached a place called Nahawand. Now Nahawand is in Iran. It is in Iran, and the Muslims, they went there. Because why did they go there? What happened was, if you remember, when the Muslims conquered Al-Madain, the king of the Persian Empire, the emperor, he ran away, right? Yes, that's the word, he ran away, and he went all the way to Asfahan, okay, which is in present-day Iran, Asfahan. And thereafter, because he thought that the situation in Asfahan is not very strong, he thought, let me go to the strongest city in the Persian Empire, the most fortified city, which is Nahawand. So he went to Nahawand. Now, what happened was, the Muslims, they were making their way to Nahawand. And the Persians, they were preparing an even bigger army than Qadisiyah, right? Qadisiyah consisted of how many people on the Persian Empire?
120,000.
Now, this army consisted of 150,000, right? Now, can you see, so many battles have taken place so far. You've had so many hundreds of thousands coming and fighting the Muslims, and more people are just coming. This is the vastness of the Persian Empire. So the Muslims, they found out that the Persians, they are preparing a huge, huge army, 150,000 strong. Now, they wrote to Umar radiallahu anhu, told him the situation. So Umar radiallahu anhu, he told them to gather a army again, the same size that you face in Qadisiyah, and make a person by the name of Nu'man ibn Muqarrin the leader. Now Nu'man ibn Muqarrin, his story is that initially he was appointed as a governor of one of the cities, right? Now, when he was appointed as a governor of one of the cities, Nu'man radiallahu anhu, he said that, "Oh Umar, I don't want to be a governor. I don't desire the dunya, because if I become a governor, I'm scared that the dunya will take me away from the deen. So I don't want you to put me as a governor. Rather, I want to be fi sabilillah, in the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, fighting for the sake of Allah." So Umar radiallahu anhu, he accepted, and he told him that you will be, because of your sincerity, you will be the leader of this army that will face Nahawand. Now they went to Nahawand, and what happened was, Nahawand, when they got there, they surrounded the entire city. But then they realized that Nahawand is protected by mountains on all four sides. Right? The place where this was, where Kisra and all the army they were waiting, it is surrounded. They're very clever, the Persians, right? They thought that we'll go there because they can't attack us from all sides, they can only attack from one side. So all the other sides were protected by mountains, and you had the gate in the middle, and this was the only way to go in. And the Muslims, they knew that if we go in through this way, we're going to get massacred, because you have 150,000 soldiers waiting behind this gate, and you only have 30,000 Muslims. As soon as the gate opens, we're going to be dead, right? There's no tactics. You don't remember the tactics they used to use? One segment there, another division there, another division there. They used to split up. You can't do that now, because there's only one entrance, right? So now they were in a big, you know, problem. What are we going to do? So Nu'man ibn Muqarrin radiallahu anhu, he consulted all the top generals that were there, one of them being Tulayha ibn Khuwaylid al-Asadi. That Tulayha radiallahu anhu, he was one of the top generals in the army. Now he asked him that, "What should we do, O Tulayha?" Now remember Tulayha, what did we say about Tulayha yesterday? Good, mashallah. The youngster knows, mashallah. Well done. He is one of the false prophets at the time of the Prophet, or after the Prophet passed away. He was one of the false prophets, but he eventually made tawbah and he accepted Islam, and he became one of the top generals in Islam. So you asked him, now the idea that he came up with was that what you do, you split the army into three parts. The first part of the army, each division will have 10,000 men. The first part of the army will be right in front of the gate. And what they will do, when the gate opens and when the battle begins, they will pretend to go march forward, and they will pretend to be scared and run away, right? So they will fake it, basically. They will pretend that they are attacking the army, and then they will pretend to be scared and run away. Then the second army will be behind this first army, far away where the Persians can't see them. When they are running away, the second army, their job is to charge. Can you see? Then the third army will be split up into further two parts, 5,000 on the side of the gate and the other 5,000 on the other side of the gate. Can you see how clever Tulayha radiallahu anhu is? So this is exactly what they did. So they made all of these divisions. The battle began, the gates opened, and the first batch, the 10,000, the first batch that was right in front of the gate, they charged towards this huge Persian army. When they saw this huge Persian army, they pretended to be scared and they pretended to flee away, right? So now what does that mean? When they are fleeing away, what will happen to the Persian army? They will start chasing them, right? They will come out of their, you know, their base, basically. So they started running after this first 10,000 men, this first batch. But then what happened? When these 10,000 were running away, the other 10,000 were waiting behind them, and they were charging forward. Now, once the purpose behind it is to bring all of the Persians outside of their fortified area. Now, once they have come outside, these 5,000 on the right hand side and 5,000 on the left hand side will go behind the army. So now what has happened?
They're trapped.
Can you see? This is the tactic of Tulayha radiallahu anhu. This is exactly what happened. And they went out, they were surrounded, they understood the amazing tactics of the Muslims. They were surrounded, and eventually the Muslims, they conquered this huge, huge army. Even though a lot of Muslims, they suffered, you know, the leader of the Muslims, Nu'man ibn Muqarrin radiallahu anhu, he passed away, he was shaheed as well. And Hudhayfa radiallahu anhu, thereafter, he became the leader of the Muslims. And, you know, even Tulayha radiallahu anhu, he became a martyr as well. So a lot of Muslims passed away, but eventually what happened was, after severe battle, eventually Nahawand fell into the hands of the Muslims. Now who was there in Nahawand? Who was the main guy? Yes, Dazraj, right? He was the main, he was the emperor of the Persian Empire. He eventually got killed as well. Now this battle, the battle of Nahawand, marked the end of the Persian Empire, right? It marked the end of the Persian Empire. You still had other governors who were, the Persian Empire was huge. It went inside of Afghanistan as well. It went, you know, it hit parts of India as well. So the Persian Empire was massive, you know, Turkey, all of that as well. So what happened was, this marked the end of the Persian Empire because why? The emperor has passed away. The major cities of the Persian Empire have all collapsed. There's no capital city anymore. And all of the cities that the Muslims have conquered, what did Umar radiallahu anhu do? Umar radiallahu anhu, he sent people from Medina to go and he appointed them governors there. That you are now the governor of Al-Madain. You are the governor of Al-Hira. You are governor of this city, that city. Why? To make sure things don't go out of hand. To make sure none of the non-Muslims who are living there under Muslim rule, they don't rebel against the state. Make sure that they are paying their tax on time, etc. To, you know, to just to govern all of their affairs. Now, the Persian Empire has collapsed, but you still had loads of small cities where you had the Persian governors still based there. So the conquest didn't end there, it continued. And what happened was that they continued marching, they conquered, you know, there's so much detail that we can't mention, but under the, you know, the leadership of Hudhayfa radiallahu anhu, Hudhayfa ibn al-Yamama radiallahu anhu, they continued marching, they conquered Asfahan, and they conquered loads of small cities in Iran. Eventually Iran, most of Iran fell into the hands of the Muslims. Thereafter they went to Armenia. Right, you know Armenia?
Right.
Armenia, they went there, they conquered Armenia, they conquered Azerbaijan as well, right? All of these places, they conquered that. Then they went to a few places in Afghanistan. It's all at the time of Umar radiallahu anhu. Brothers from Afghanistan, put your hand up here. Nice and high, come on, don't be shy, come on. Yes, mashallah. See, I'm sure there's more, but you're shy, you know. The Afghanis can't be shy, come on. If the Afghanis are shy, then what is our state going to be, subhanAllah? So Afghanistan at that time was under the Persian rule, but what happened? Because Umar radiallahu anhu, he told them to continue marching, you know, this momentum that was going on, to continue going on, they went all the way to places in Afghanistan, and they conquered places in Afghanistan as well. Thereafter, they went all the way to Turkey. They, you know, the Kurds in Turkey, they conquered them as well. So all of these places, subhanAllah, dear brothers, you know, all of us, we're Muslim today, you know, we are indebted to Umar radiallahu anhu, wallahi. You know, even brothers from Africa as well sitting here, we're coming to Africa, don't worry. You know, that's on the other side. We're talking about one side of the globe, we're going to come to the other side still, right? Now, can you see now, the tactic of Umar was that conquest take place on the right-hand side, so the Muslims were moving all the way up, you know, all the way east. And then you had the west side where, you know, the Muslims were conquering the Roman Empire. So they were going up, like that. Can you see? So the Muslim Empire was expanding. Now, this is the, you know, the amazing rule of Umar radiallahu anhu. The fact that, subhanAllah, when you study all of these historical events, the fact that Umar, at the time of Umar radiallahu anhu, you know, Sahabis like Hudhayfa radiallahu anhu, they went to Afghanistan, they went to all of these, you know, amazing different countries. And the fact that we are, subhanAllah, all Muslims, because of these companions, radiallahu anhu, right? This is a very, very, you know, great honor that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us, that because we are, you know, carrying on this legacy that the Sahaba, radiallahu anhu, they left behind in these places, right? Now, one last point before we finish. There is one hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam which talks about the fall of the Persian and the Roman Empire. This hadith is that the Prophet ﷺ, he said that the Persian Empire, the Muslims will conquer the Persian Empire with one or two big knocks. Right? This is the wording that is used in the hadith. One or two big knocks. Now what is this knock referring to? The ulama, they mentioned that the first knock was the Battle of Qadisiyah, and the second big knock was the Battle of Nahawand. Right? And then he said, as for the Roman Empire, the Prophet ﷺ said, the Roman Empire, they are going to be so difficult to face, that whenever one horn of the Roman Empire disappears, another horn will grow in that place. Right? This is the Roman Empire. Giving the news to the Muslims that when you start the conquest of the Roman Empire, of Asham, of Egypt, of Palestine, of Jordan, Libya, all of these countries, then it is not going to be an easy task. Because the Roman Empire were just, if not stronger, than the Persian Empire, right? And inshallah, from tomorrow we're going to start the conquest of the Persian, or of the Roman Empire, inshallah. We are going to conquer the Roman Empire, inshallah. We're going to go on this journey, inshallah. Alright, so we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to accept this gathering with us, and inshallah we'll continue tomorrow. Wa akhiru da'wan alhamdulillahi rabbil alamin. Jazakallahu khairan.